The increase started in 30 minus 20, 10. 27 minus 20, 7. 25 minus 25, 10. So they are becoming very large. Okay. Would it lower if I moved it to 25? I said, I know, I accept your definition and I take X bar and I get 25. Will the deviations lower? Yes. The deviations now have become minus 5, minus 2, then 0, then 2 plus 2,
2 pi.
Sorry. So I have got these. When I square these, each one is squared. And as I move from here, I will find that the sum of squared, which in the earlier case was 10, 10, 7, 5, 3. Now the sum of these squares is obviously lower than the sum of this. So by the whichever formula I am taking, if I take this formula, okay, I am getting one result, which is not minimizing the sum. So the formula is derived from this process of minimizing the sum of squared deviations. Minimize. It requires a little bit of calculus. You have done calculus, one of them? So you can look up and say how this is. You got the intuitive idea what it means. By shifting this, I can get different deviation and therefore a higher square of deviations or a lower one. I try and call that as the estimator or formula which gives me the least. If you derive this by minimization using calculus, you will get from here you will get by using calculus. Okay, you, what you have to do, you have to minimize the sum of squares from mu. Okay, so I have to minimize the sum of squares from mu. And which means that I place this derivative with respect to mu, put it equal to 0, and I get a formula. That formula you will find is equal to, can see it in your books, is equal to x bar in this case. Not in all cases, but in this case, the method of moments has given you the same result as the least squares. We are trying to understand what these mean. Least squares method is essentially minimizing the sum of squared errors. And from that, I get a formula. So, from a criterion to what? The third method is the method of maximum likelihood. Okay, we are almost near lunch. So, there is the maximum likelihood that we are all hungry. Okay. So now let's understand this once. Suppose I was to draw a sample in this class about male and female. And in my sample, I got a sample of Y and I wrote, okay, female is equal to 1, male is equal to 0. It's a bivariate. And I got a sample which is 1, 0, 1. One, a sample of y, one. This is the sample I got with replacement. I have to ask this question, what population does it come from? What population will is it coming from? Okay, now if my population had only one only, suppose this was my population, only one. There is no male in this class. Would I have got this sample? Would I have got a sample which says that 1, 0, 0, 0, here two samples from this class. So this is a better sample, yes. But it could be taken because the population is different. So now we say, given this population, given this sample, what is the type of population which I will get, which is maximizes the likelihood of getting this sample? Let me repeat. What is that population which is maximizing the likelihood of getting this sample? That is the method of maximum likelihood, extensively used in higher levels of economics. Okay? But I will explain this, but please understand these are the three methods that are used. You can use a fourth method, which is called the BLUE method, best linear unbiased estimate. In this, what I do is I make my formula, okay, let's say x tilde is my formula, not x bar, as a linear function. This is best linear unbiased estimate. I do this. I first make L, use that L1. I use x tilde as a linear function of the sample. Next, I say I try to minimize the variance. That is called the blue, E for blue. I try to minimize that. Okay? And of course, that's the third step. Second step is I have to put a condition of unbiasedness. I'll explain all these terms after that. Unbiasedness. And putting these conditions, the mathematical derivation gives you the formula. In this case, again, you will find this is equal to x bar. But in many advanced levels, you may not find all these equal to the same one. So please do not panic. I'll explain in this detail. Please do not panic in the sense that econometrics uses a huge amount of jargon, large number of concepts. Those concepts have simple meanings. This meaning of this concept is, take the sample made and put it on the population. This one says minimize the sum of squared errors or variance. Sorry, not variance, deviations. This one says if you have drawn a sample and you assume that the population is a normal population, so what type of normal population would have given you this sample? So maximize the likelihood of that. And this one says that, well, you can build in the condition of linearity and derive the conditions. So these are methods of deriving the estimators. Okay. I don't want to give it in the class, but I have got the derivations and examples. I can give it to you, photocopy. You can do that, but you can see it in a book. So, is that time for lunch? Sorry, 5 minutes. Okay. So, are you with me?
Yes, sir.
So, you have to be with me for 5 days. So, today only it has, as I said, today will be a more difficult day because we are doing the. Okay, but I am giving it at a simple level without proofs. Okay, no proofs, yes. Estimator is not what you are going to derive. Estimator has been derived by econometrician statisticians. They have derived formulae from these criteria.
Oh.
You don't have to do that. Yeah. You will find some estimators can be used in some cases or desirable to be used in some cases. In some cases they are not desirable or cannot be used. But the criteria I have laid down, I can explain them a little more if you wish and find this there later on. But basically, it must have certain properties. So after coming back, we'll look at the properties of these estimates. I have just taken the lowest, but does it have a good property? It if it has a good property, yes. You should use mine and not that.
Is there some method by which I find out the
answer is yes, there are a certain set of criteria. One great thing is the most which are called properties of a good estimator. Properties of a good estimator. There are two types of properties.
Only these.
So 30 I got one estimate. using X bar as the estimate. I got 23 as an estimate second time. I got another 25 as an estimate third time like that. If I do it 10,000 times, I get what was just mentioned. I get a distribution of the X bar. Okay? A distribution of the X bar. Most of the times it will be around the population mean. But you will get 23 sometimes, you will get 30 sometimes, it will be around that. Unbiasedness property is that on an average, that is if you repeat this exercise again and again, 10,000 times, then X, the average of X bar written as what we call expected values of X bar is equal to I will get different values of X bar each time. But on an average, the mean of this distribution of X bar, mean of the distribution, okay, I have done this experiment again and again, 10,000 times. So I have got a distribution. So on an average, it will be around the mean. That is the property of unbiasedness. But suppose the population mean was here. And my distribution of X bar is here, then on an average I am not getting the population mean. That is biased. That is like the person going to office every day half an hour late. And he says my estimate is, I used calculus to derive my estimate. How in fuck did you see your doctor?
That's wrong.
It doesn't matter. Calculus has to be a proper property. The first property is you make errors. Each sample will give you a different estimate. But the average of this must be equal to the true estimate. The average of this must be equal to the true estimate. That is the meaning of unbiasedness. It is like someone who is using a rifle and there is this target. So there is the bullseye, inner circle. Now he is hitting all the time on the right hand side. That is biased. You hit around that circuit, okay, then it is unbiased. Got it? It's around that hit. And the average of this must be equal or very close to the population parameter. In this case, it is equal. That is the property of an unbiased. The second property is the property of what we call the minimum, that is the best or efficiency. Okay. Efficiency, the second case of efficiency. So I have X bar as the estimator of mu. I could have used Oshii's formula also. I could have used X median also. All these are for estimators of mu. Okay, all these are estimators of mu. Suppose I had drawn using the median repeated samples of size 5. I'll get, once I get one median, let's say 23, another time I get 27, another time I get the median as 29, and like that. So I will get different median. Okay. That median also will be distributed something like this, let's say. But that median may have a larger variance. Okay. The variance means the spread is more. Okay. Efficiency means minimum variance. Minimum variance. So among the estimators and among the unbiased estimators, you have to pick only those estimators which are minimum variance. It's like among the guns that you have, all of them unbiased. Let's say you are choosing between 5-6 guns. All of them you found to be unbiased. You're a good shooter. Nothing, no problem with you. Okay. They're striking around the good side, But some are striking, the variance are very far. Okay, the points are different places. So that is a higher variance. So one gun may give me with the full side. So if they are hitting here, this is one gun. It is unbiased. But there is another gun which is zero in this way, which is hitting. It is also unbiased. But which one is a better gun, the cross gun or the zero gun? Cross gun is the better gun. Because they are hitting near the full side. Okay, they are around. So this one, this cross one is what we call the efficient estimator or the efficient gun in this case. This is efficient because it has less of variance. This one is hitting all around. Okay, it's not inaccurate. Like in the World War, earlier World War, they used to bomb. The bomb would fall somewhere far away. It's not an accurate. Okay. Now they fall very close to the target. Okay. They may not hit the target every time, but they will fall close. So we say that an efficient estimator is one which is having a less of a variance.
Sir, we are not aware of population mean.
No.
How can we then make it out that population mean is near to this and we have to select that estimator which is near to that value?
You don't have to do anything. You have to follow what has already been proven. Okay. So what we are saying, we are building the base. All this is derived. Okay. You don't have to. It is derived which estimator has what properties. And this is derived mathematically. The derivation of the formula is also mathematical from the criteria. Their properties are also derived already using mathematics. Okay. But the critical, there are two basic assumptions in these. One assumption is that the population is normally distributed. Okay, that is the most important assumption. Second is you are taking samples which are random. That is, probability of each one being selected is the same. So given these two very critical assumptions, you can prove all the other assumptions. I can show one or two times, just one. Now what this means is that the variance of this estimator, what we say is variance of x bar, if x bar is efficient, okay, must be less than of all other variances, of variances of all other estimators. Say for example, it is less than variance of x social, or less equal to variance of median, etc. Then we say x bar is an efficient estimate. This one, the first one was x bar, the second one was with the larger variance is median. Now this is a very strange, very difficult thing to say. There can be so many formulas. Dozens of them. How do I find out which formula I will see minimum variance and some formulas may be discovered in future? The answer is yes, that is true, it is difficult, but there are two criteria. One is that you simplify your life and say among the linear estimators. What is a linear estimator? Well, the estimator is a linear combination of the sample observations. Okay, among the linear estimators, you say which is the least. So that type of thing is called, someone has asked me not to write below, so I am going up here. Okay. Among the estimators, the third criteria is blue. Best. So it's an estimator derived from that is the formula. It is unbiased because on an average its distribution will be around the population mean. Okay, population parameter. Okay. Like this one. It is efficient, therefore it is best. It is also a linear combination of the population. Okay, of sample observations. So for example, X bar, is it a linear combination of the sample? Yes, the answer is, what was the sample size? 5. So I got 1/5 into X1 plus 1/5 into X2, like that. And how many I got? X5. It's a linear combination. It's a formula which is a linear combination of the observations. So this is linear. X bar is linear. It is unbiased, as we can see. Why is it unbiased? Because you expect generally. You will expect, suppose this is your X bar. We say the expected value, or the on an average what you are going to get, the expected value of this is equal to the expected value of the bar. If you take this out, what you are going to get is 1 by n xi, sorry, x1 plus 1 by n into x2, like that.
Xn.
Now the expected value of this,
okay,
you have to look up the expected value which are given there, some of them. Okay. Expected value of a constant is also why? Because it does not change. There is no average of a constant. It is always the same. So I can rewrite this as 1 by n expected, sorry, expected value of x1 plus 1 by n expected value of x2 and so on. But x1 is normally distributed. X1, x's are normally distributed. As we said, that is our one of the critical, two critical assumptions. One assumption is x's are normally distributed. So each of these are normally distributed with mean equal to mu and variance equal to sigma. Okay. So the expected values of all these will be, it will become 1 by n mu plus 1 by n mu and so on. If you sum it up, you will get, okay, you will get n times 1 by n into n times mu. This will cancel, you will get. So expected value of x bar, this is to show how it is derived. The expected value, that means if you have taken the sample again and again and each time calculated x bar, the average of that would have been equal to mu, mathematically. This is how you go about showing whether it is what correct characteristic or not. So x bar is unbiased. X bar is also minimum variance because it is, as we said, it is can be derived from Bloom criteria, but you can also prove it separately. You can prove it separately for linear combinations. So x bar is also efficient, and therefore x bar is Bloom, the best linear unbiased estimator of what?
Population parameter.
Of population average, which is mu. Okay. It is 3, 3, unknown. Okay?
So
this is a small sample from it.
So why do we consider linearity as a good indicator of
it? We need not consider, it is a simpler indicator. Linearity, in this case, you can have very complicated formulae also. If linearity does not work, or you need not in are not interested in, you can take some other criteria and begin with it.
Okay, we can like is there such thing like we prefer linear estimators over quadratic estimators, or there is nothing like that?
Well, we prefer linear indicators, that is true.
Just for the sake of mathematical simplification.
Yes, that is true. But if the linear indicator things do not have the required properties, these properties, unbiasedness, minimum variance, okay, then we may discard a linear estimator and go for a non-linear estimator also. But to derive that, you will not get it from the least squares estimate. You will get it from the maximum likelihood estimates. That is why maximum likelihood is in a use in econometrics at a higher level. Okay. So, I'll explain to you what that is a little later. So, these are what is called small sample property or fixed sample size property. What was the sample size in this case?
5.
So all these properties are for a small sample size, in this case equal to 5. But what happens if you increase the sample size? Now, you have all given me your ages and I put it in a bowl. I picked up with replacement, not 5 but 10. Okay, 10 times I have picked up. So what will happen? So it's kind of still. It's with replacement, but the sample size has changed from 5 to 10. So when the sample size increases, and approaches infinity, you can say, okay, then these properties kick in. These are asymptotic properties. As sample size approaches infinity, becomes larger and larger, larger the sample size. Okay? So if I had a sample size of 1, I would get only 1 edge. Maybe my edge comes in. Okay? Is that a good estimator? Or a good estimate, sorry. Good estimate of the of mu in this class? No, my aid is not. So sample size 1 is not a good thing. 2, maybe you get a larger variance also. Maybe Mr. 7 I my aid get picked up. Or 2 youngest pupils get picked up. 3, is it better? 4, 5, 7, 8, that will it be better and better results? So as you increase the sample size, you will get better and better results. Suppose it was sample size only 1, then there is no average being collected, being calculated. It's not a unbiased estimate. Okay? That means any x that I pick up, okay, is like the soup case. Okay. Any spoon I pick up could be a good estimator or give a good estimate of the temperature of the soup because it is uniformly distributed. But not here. So as the sample size increases, we get what is called asymptotic unbiasedness. Similarly, we get asymptotic efficiency. And these two taken together is actually called consistent estimates. This is a very important word, consistent. That is, the value is of your estimator will collapse on the two values in the population. Okay, let me explain this. As I increase the sample size and for getting the mean age, was I getting a better estimate of each time?
Yes.
Better estimate. Okay. So, as I increase this, why do you think it was better? Because one, it's becoming more and more representative of the population, that is true. But also, the variance of this is going to reduce. Okay? As I said, if it is only one observation, then it is my age, two, my age and his age, and maybe some two youngest persons in another sample. So there is a huge variance of your experts. But if I increase the sample size, the variance reduces. Okay. So, and if I, can I have a population of 51 and a sample size of 51? You can have, theoretically, yes. Can I have a sample size of 501 with a population of 51? Why? Because you are doing with replacement. Okay. So it is possible to have? Again, with replacement you are doing, you can have an infinite. So, as you increase the size of the sample, the variance becomes less and less, and the distribution of X bars actually becomes higher peak, and it finally collapses on the true value. That is the meaning of consistency. Consistency means whether it collapses on the true value as you increase the sample size to infinite. In technical jargon, it's called the probability limit. The probability limit as n approaches infinity. It is equal to mean. Have you done this in your class? How is the X bar distributed? That means you take repeated samples of size n. How will the X bar be distributed? It will be distributed normally with mean, mu, and variance. Sigma square
by n.
By n. Okay, you have done this. Okay, so I will not repeat this. But basically what it means is that if I were to draw repeated samples, for one sample I get x1 bar of same size. I get x2 bar from this another sample, from x3 bar. I get 10,000 such x bars from sample size. These would be distributed, these x bars would be distributed normally with mean mu, this is the x bar distribution. So x bar is distributed normally, this is how you write normally, okay? Distributed normally with mean mu and variance sigma square by n. So as n approaches infinity, where does sigma square by n approach? So the distribution collapses on the true value. The true value is mu. It's around mu. As n approaches infinity, the variance becomes less and less, and finally it becomes zero. It approaches zero. The probability limit is zero in this case. Sorry, mu in this case. Okay. So this is what we use for. This is what we are going to use for in statistics to do inference and for hypothesis testing. This is what we use. Now, so can we prove the unbiasedness of certain things? Of these estimates, the answer is yes. We just prove it for experts. Can we say prove the minimum variance? We can prove in the case of linear estimators. Easily, but in the case of non-linear or any estimator, all that, there is a maximum likelihood lower bound. is a lower bound. Don't worry about that, the lower bound of it. That uses maximum likelihood methods, which I will explain. I think it needs to be explained later. So there is this possibility to get the lowest possible, some idea of what is going to be the lowest possible failure. So these are the we can prove blue, just now we did for X bar. We have also proven that X bar is also asymptotically efficient in the sense its variance reduces and it collapses on the true distribution because as n approaches infinity, variance approaches infinity. Have you got this? Now what about the weight? Take a deep breath. Okay, everyone fine? Are you with me? Okay. So, one more. Is there a variance of age in this class?
Yeah.
There is a mu and there is also
variance
which is called sigma square. It is called sigma square. Okay. Do I know the variance? Do you know the variance of age in this class?
No.
No, you don't know. How will you find out? You will take a sample and look at if you were going to use the variance of the sample as the variance of the population, what would you call it? What method would you call it? Method of moments, which uses the sample variance as a population variance. Okay. I can do this. I can find out this formula for the sample variance as an estimator by using any other criteria. Which other criteria can I use? I can use D square. Okay. Don't use blue. Only D square or I can maximum likelihood. I can get the variance formula. Now that variance formula which I get, suppose I use the method of least square or any other formula and I got a variance formula, sorry, method of moments, and I got the sample variance as being the estimator of the population variance. So what is the formula for the sample variance? What is the formula for the sample variance? What is variance? It is deviation from the mean square. There is no summation. There is the same summation divided by. Suppose I call this hat. Hat means for the sample. Okay. And this is mean. Now, you also use another one. You use S square, which is equal to divided by. Why do you use the two different ones? Why do you use n minus 1 divided by n minus 1? Any idea?
X bar is the population mean.
Yes. X bar is not population. X bar is always sample. That's the first thing in the morning you said. Why do you do this? Why n minus 1 and not n? Because your teacher said so, because it will pass you in the exam. Yes, that is true. That is all good reasons. But there must be something else. Some other reason also. The reason is that for small samples, this one gives you a biased. This is a biased estimator of the population variance. Okay. I can give you the proofs, but it is a biased estimator of the population variance. And S square is an unbiased estimator of the population variance. Okay. It is unbiased. So if you took different samples and each time calculated by the first formula, that is sigma hat square, you will get the distribution of sigma hat square not around the population variance sigma square, but somewhere different. The mean will not be the mean of the variances will not be sigma square. To correct for that, we use this one. And there is a reason why we use this. Please understand this. I'm just introducing concepts without giving you proofs, but just to make you understand. Suppose I had three numbers. Suppose I had these three numbers. 2, 4, 6. What is the mean of that? So the mean is sum of this is 12 divided by 3, which is, so my x bar is 4. Now I have calculated x bar. Now I am giving two numbers to you. Okay. 2 and 6. And the x bar is 4. 2 and 6 are given and the x bar is 4. Can you find the third number? Can you find the third number?
Yes.
What is the third number?
4.
Okay. What you have done is you are not free to choose this number anymore. It has to be 4. Why? Because you have used up your observations to find x bar. This is called degrees of freedom. You lose 1 degree of freedom because you have used the n observations to calculate x bar. You can fix n minus 1 numbers freely, you can choose them freely. But once x bar is correct, you can't choose the last number because already x bar is there. So you lose a degree of freedom. So what is important here is this concept of degree of freedom. Okay. A degree of freedom is if you have already calculated one from the any estimator, one estimator has been used, then you lose 1 degree of freedom. And to deal with that problem, we remove from N1 and we get n minus 1 of the denominator. Because 1 degree of freedom has been used up for calculating x bar. This is the idea of degree of freedom. It's a very important one, degree of freedom. What it means, you can choose, so x, you have 10 numbers, you can choose 9 of them if you are given mean x bar. You can't choose all 10 because x bar says that 9 you can choose on your own, the 10th will follow. The 10th will follow because x bar is there. So the degree of freedom is 9 in that case. So you have lost 1 degree of freedom for choosing, for calculating x bar. Okay. This is enough for the properties of estimators. Okay. This is one last point. So this is unbiased. Okay. It is unbiased. What happens if n approaches infinity?
It becomes biased.
S square is unbiased. And n approaches infinity, what happens?
It becomes biased.
S square.
It becomes biased.
S square tends to 0. Okay, divided by infinity is 0. So it tends to, so is it a, S square, is it a consistent estimator?
Yes.
Yes. If the first one is consistent estimator, sigma hats the case, it is consistent. Even that is consistent. Okay. It will collapse on the true value later on as the sample size increases. So for large samples, it doesn't matter whether you use the first formula or the second formula. But for small sample size, it matters whether you use the first formula or the second formula. So the concept is very, you have got the concept of what is the meaning of unbiasedness. You make errors each time you calculate x bar, but or you calculate sigma square, each time you get a different value, which is different from the true value of the population. If you do this 10,000 times, you will have a distribution. Okay. We have to see what distribution this is for sigma square. For x bar, we know it is normally distributed, and we know its mean and its variance. Okay. So this is the part up to which we can take a little one more step further. Are you okay with me, Julia? Okay? Okay, now this expectation which I have used there is given here, but you can try out, you can keep this with you and see how expectations are used. This slide gives you, I have given you the function, this was done before lunch. This is done now. The probability distribution, we have done probability distributions also. Now what is this probability distribution?
Not.
Okay. It has a mu. It has a sigma standard deviation in the population. How much is the area under this whole thing? What is the area between mu and mu minus one standard deviation? Okay. Similarly here. So if I was to say, please tell me approximately how much is the area from between what to what will be the area for this distribution, which will cover 95% of this area approximately. So it will be 34 plus. Okay, 35, let's say, 35 plus.
13.5.
So somewhere here.
Plus minus 3.
Plus minus 2.
Up
to standard deviations in the population. Okay. Like that you can find out. Okay. If I ask you what is, suppose I get a value which is mu plus 3 standard deviation, what is the probability that it is it high or is it low?
Very low.
Very low. Something which has occurred with a very low probability. Okay. Remember that? We have done. Have a look at it again. This is the formula for a normal distribution. Don't bother about it. Now, there is a problem with the normal distribution. What is the problem? You have done standard normal?
Yes.
What is the problem with the normal distribution? I can't use it meaningfully. Can you tell me the problem? Have you done this? Do you know standard normal distribution?
Yes, sir.
You have heard of it?
Yes, sir.
Everyone? So what is the mean of a standard normal distribution?
Zero.
And what is its variance?
1.
And how did I get it from the normal distribution?
X minus 1.
Okay, very good class. Excellent class. After lunch they are answering. So I have got